Good evening, I'm Amna Nawaz.
And I'm Jeff Bennett. On the NewsHour tonight, Congress works to avoid a partial government shutdown. But could it cost the House Speaker his gavel?
Princess Kate Middleton announces she has cancer after weeks of speculation about her health.
And the first Muslim American nominated to be on a federal appeals court hits a roadblock, with both Republicans and Democrats voicing concerns.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Jim and Nancy Bildner and the Robert and Virginia Schiller Foundation.
On an American Cruise Lines journey along the legendary Mississippi River, travelers explore Civil War battlefields and historic riverside towns. Aboard our fleet of American riverboats, you can experience local culture and cuisine and discover the music and history of the mighty Mississippi. American Cruise Lines, proud sponsor of PBS NewsHour.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. The federal government is just hours away from partially shutting down as Capitol Hill scrambles to finalize its $1.2 trillion spending deal.
The bill would keep the lights on, but could also cost the speaker his job. Congressional correspondent Lisa Desjardins is here with more on the deal and why House Republicans now face the threat of yet another chaotic leadership surge. Lisa, let's start with this shutdown deadline. We're just 6 hours away. Where do things stand?
All right. The House passed this bill that would fund the rest of government. 70% of government agencies need funding or they'll start shutting down this weekend. They passed that barely today, just 5 or 6 votes to spare. The Senate now needs to act by midnight. Here is, at this minute, minute-to-minute decisions being made in the Senate. And right now, Amna, it looks like we may, in fact, get to that midnight deadline without this getting through the Senate. Senator Susan Collins has just said that, other staffers confirming. The two sides are not agreeing over amendments that they want to vote on for this. Everyone knows amendments won't pass. This is all election year symbolic votes, but they can't agree on it. Adding to this, Senator Susan Collins, top Republican appropriator, her mother's funeral is tomorrow in Maine. She's never missed a vote, so it's not a factor in what happens, but it is adding to the pressure around all of this. Right now, it looks like we could very well have a weekend shutdown.
Meanwhile, just yesterday, you were reporting on the rebellion, the dysfunction, the infighting among House Republicans. Today, House Speaker Johnson is now moving forward with this spending bill, and one of his Republican members is moving to oust him. What's happening?
As you're saying, this is connected. As we were watching that dramatic floor vote to see if government would be funded, Marjorie Taylor Greene, the Republican from Georgia, took a small piece of paper over to what's called the hopper, where you file bills. I watched her put it in. It was a motion to vacate the chair. She says that she is now, as they have the right under the new House rules, any member can raise this idea. This is how Kevin McCarthy was ousted. She says she is not yet invoking this. She didn't call for the vote today, but she says she intends to. You can hear the difference between her and other Republicans as they came outside after this action.
I do not wish to inflict pain on our conference and to throw the House in chaos, but this is basically a warning, and it's time for us to go through the process, take our time, and find a new Speaker of the House that will stand with Republicans and our Republican majority instead of standing with the Democrats.
Not only idiotic, but it actually does not do anything to advance the conservative movement, and in fact, it undermines the country and our majority.
So this, again, puts us in a position. The House has gone on recess, but when they come back, the position will be, again, to have to deal potentially with a speaker fight. Marjorie Taylor Greene is not someone who backs down. The issue is, does she have any others with her right now?
It's hard to imagine another speaker fight among House Republicans. What does this mean going forward?
All right, let's look at the votes exactly, because things are very tight in the House of Representatives. First of all, when you're looking at the margins, it has changed because Ken Buck has left. We now have 218 Republicans after his departure, 213 Democrats. That means a majority in the House right now is 216. Johnson can lose just two Republicans and keep his speakership with all Republican support, or he will have to get support from Democrats. I talked to Democratic Representative Tom Suozzi. He was just won that special election to replace George Santos. He right away said, I will support Speaker Johnson. So there's one Democratic vote, but other Democrats say, if we're gonna support Speaker Johnson, we wanna get something out of it. This is gonna lead to perhaps days of instability, or maybe Speaker Johnson weathers the next 2 weeks. One thing is for sure, Marjorie Taylor Greene is gonna make a lot of money in fundraising probably off of this.
Meanwhile, there was more news related to those numbers you just showed us there. That slim Republican majority is about to get even slimmer.
This was such a dramatic Friday. We also had an unexpected piece of news from a very high-profile Republican member, Mike Gallagher of Wisconsin. He was just on this program, I believe it was last week, talking about the TikTok bill. He's an up-and-coming rising star in the party, 40 years old, four-termer. We know he was going to leave Congress this term, but he announced today he's leaving early. He's leaving mid-April. He says he talked to his family. He does not want to be in the House anymore. Now, what this means is that narrow majority gets even slimmer. Let's look at that same graphic I just showed you. After he leaves, look at that. Now it's down to 217 Republicans. And then look, Johnson could lose just one Republican vote and get something through the House. So on the positive side, they are going to have to work together, Democrats and Republicans, to pass legislation. On the negative side, they don't have a good history of being able to do that, and it's an election year. Speaker Johnson, he is someone who talks about the Bible. I hope he's read the book of Job, because he's having so much political difficulty and challenges. We'll see how he gets through it.
We will see. Lisa Desjardins covering a busy Friday on Capitol Hill. Lisa, thank you.
Welcome.
In the day's other headlines, gunfire erupted at a rock concert outside Moscow today. Russia's lead security service reported 40 people were killed and more than 100 wounded. Video showed the Crocus City Hall ablaze before part of the roof collapsed. News accounts said gunmen in combat fatigues fired automatic weapons and threw explosives. Russian officials called it a terror attack. Ukraine denied it had anything to do with the shootings. A tense meeting in Tel Aviv today spotlighted the strains in U.S.-Israeli relations over the war in Gaza. Secretary of State Antony Blinken spoke with Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, but afterward, the prime minister again insisted on invading Rafah, the last Hamas stronghold.
I told him that I greatly appreciate that we've been standing together in the war. But I also said that we have no way to defeat Hamas without going into Rafah and eliminating the rest of the battalions there. And I told him that I hope we will do it with the support of the USA. But if we have to, we will do it alone.
Later at the airport, Blinken said the US and Israel still share the goal of defeating Hamas, but they differ sharply on the strategy.
A major military ground operation in Rafah is not the way to do it. It risks killing more civilians. It risks wreaking greater havoc with the provision of humanitarian assistance. It risks further isolating Israel around the world and jeopardizing its long-term security and standing.
The Tel Aviv meeting came as the Palestinian Health Ministry in Gaza reported the death toll has passed 32,000, with more than 74,000 injured. Russia and China vetoed a U.S.-sponsored resolution supporting a ceasefire in Gaza in a vote today at the U.N. Security Council. Ambassadors from Moscow and Beijing said the resolution did not specifically demand a halt to the fighting and would let Israel act with impunity.
This would definitively close the door when it comes to discussions about the need for a ceasefire in Gaza. This would free the hands of Israel, and it would result in all of Gaza and its entire population having to face destruction, devastation, or expulsion. We are not guided by what is convenient for Washington and its satellites.
In response, U.S. Ambassador Linda Thomas-Greenfield said that Russia and China opposed the resolution because it also condemned the Hamas attack on Israel that killed 1,200 people last October. More than a million people in Ukraine lost power today after a sweeping Russian attack on the electrical grid. At least 60 drones and 90 rockets rained down across the country, killing at least five people. Cell phone video captured missiles striking a dam in Zaporizhzhia that feeds power to a nuclear plant. Officials said the dam was not in danger of breaching. Back in this country, former President Donald Trump's social media company completed a merger that stands to greatly increase his wealth. He'll own the majority stake, and his shares could be worth more than $3 billion. But company rules bar Mr. Trump from selling any of that stock for 6 months, so he cannot use it to cover a fraud judgment of $454 million that's due on Monday. And on Wall Street, stocks gave ground after three straight days of record closes. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 305 points to close below 39,476. The NASDAQ rose 27 points, but the S&P 500 fell 7. And still to come on the NewsHour, medical history is made after a pig kidney is transplanted into a human. David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart weigh in on the week's political headlines. And rock star Lenny Kravitz on his new album and international tour.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The Princess of Wales, Kate Middleton, announced this afternoon that she's undergoing treatment for cancer. The news came amid rampant and often irresponsible speculation about her in the British press and beyond. It also came after missteps by the royal family itself about her whereabouts and condition. She revealed the news in a video message shot earlier this week by the BBC studios at Windsor Castle.
In January, I underwent major abdominal surgery in London, and at the time, it was thought that my condition was non-cancerous. The surgery was successful. However, tests after the operation found cancer had been present. My medical team therefore advised that I should undergo a course of preventative chemotherapy, and I'm now in the early stages of that treatment. This, of course, came as a huge shock, and William and I have been doing everything we can to process and manage this privately for the sake of our young family.
For more, I'm joined from London by Jenny Bond, a journalist with deep insights into the royal family. Thank you for joining us. As you know, the princess hadn't been seen in public since December. In the weeks since then, it's been filled with conspiracy theories and wild speculation about her absence. Was this video today something that she or the palace wanted to release, or something they felt they had to?
I think the latter. I think we have, we as a society really have forced a young woman who is in battling cancer at the moment. And I think we have forced her into this situation. And I think it's very sad. I think we as a society should take a long look at ourselves, because the trolls on the internet have put about the most ridiculous conspiracy theories consistently. And we, the mass media, actually have given some of those theories airtime, which I think was entirely wrong. And finally, I think, yes, I think Catherine has been backed into a corner and felt that she had to stand up and make a statement. It could have been a written statement, but she's a courageous and confident young woman. And she decided to make the video herself. And I think we have to salute her bravery, as indeed her father-in-law, the King, has done already.
Do you think that the release of this video puts to rest all of that wild speculation and those conspiracy theories?
Do you know what? I think that if this doesn't silence the conspiracy theorists, then we as human beings, as a society, have to take a long, hard look in the mirror and say, what are we playing at? Now, I've reported on the royals for 35 years. I knew Diana, the former Princess of Wales, and I watched her stand up and appeal for time and space because of her mental fragility at the time, and she needed time out from her public role. Did we listen to her? No, we didn't. And I really do think if we don't listen now to this courageous young woman asking for time, space, and privacy, then there's something very, very wrong with the world.
I do need to ask you, Jenny, there was the matter during her absence of this photo, which was released by Kensington Palace on Mother's Day in the United Kingdom. It showed the Princess of Wales with her children, but it was also quickly pulled by news agencies after it was revealed that it had been manipulated. And the next day, the princess herself then tweeted saying, like many amateur photographers, I do occasionally experiment with editing. I wanted to express my apologies for any confusion the family photograph we shared yesterday caused. As you mentioned, this is a serious private medical concern, but from a public relations and messaging standpoint, could the palace have handled all this differently?
Well, yes, that photograph, I suppose, was a mistake. Though, put it in context, you know, Cecil Beaton, a very famous professional photographer who took pictures of the royals for decades, he admitted he often touched photos up, changed them around. At Prince Edward's wedding to Sophie, the photographer there admitted that William had been looking rather glum in one of the official pictures, so he transposed William's head from a happier picture and put it on the wedding picture. I mean, you know, get real, these things happen. Did it harm anyone? Absolutely not. It was a ridiculous storm in a teacup. And another way of assaulting this young princess, I think, who subsequently heard that the very hospital where she was treated for her abdominal surgery, there are allegations that members of staff had, after that, tried to access her medical records. She must feel assailed from all sides.
Of course, we're wishing her a quick recovery and good health. Jenny Bond joining us from London tonight. Thank you so much.
President Biden's nomination of the first Muslim American to a federal appeals court has come under intense criticism and appears to be in peril. Laura Barrón-López has more. Laura?
That's right, Jeff. President Biden's nominee to the Third Circuit Court of Appeals, Adil Manji, is a veteran litigator unanimously rated well-qualified by the American Bar Association. But he's faced a barrage of attacks from Republican senators, which the White House says amounts to an Islamophobic smear campaign.
Do you believe that Zionist settler colonialism was a provocation that justified Hamas's atrocity against Jews in Israel?
Do you condemn the atrocities of the Hamas terrorists?
Yes, that's what I was about to address, Senator.
Is there any justification for those atrocities?
Senator, I'll repeat myself. The events of October 7th were a horror. I have no patience, none, for any attempts to justify or defend those events.
And conservative outside groups have launched ads baselessly labeling Manji as anti-Semitic, despite his nomination being endorsed by more than a dozen Jewish organizations. To discuss this, I'm joined by former federal judge Timothy K. Lewis, who was appointed to the same circuit court of appeals as Manji by then Republican President George H.W. Bush. Judge Lewis, thank you so much for joining. I want to start by asking you, you recently sent a letter to Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer and Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell in defense of Adil Manji. Why did you feel compelled to send that?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for having me. I felt compelled to send that because of what I consider to be outrageous, baseless, and really sad attacks on Mr. Manji's character. I thought that they were, I know that they were initially rooted in his religion. They had nothing to do at all with his competence, with his experience, with his qualifications to serve on the court I was honored to sit on for a number of years. And I just thought that it's so outrageous that something had to be done. And quite honestly, it was an honor to have the opportunity to stand up on his behalf. When I have a sense that someone is being slandered and really torn down based on these kinds of untruths and bigotry and all of the horrible things that were said at the Judiciary Committee hearing and written about him afterward, there was just no way that I could stand by and allow that to happen. And frankly, I think that most Americans feel the same way.
Judge, the attacks from Republicans appears to have also had an impact on Senate Democrats. This week, Democratic Senator Catherine Cortez Masto of Nevada came out against Manji's nomination. She takes issue with Manji's affiliation with a nonprofit organization called the Alliance of Families for Justice. And she states that this organization advocated for the release of individuals convicted of killing police officers. I cannot support this nominee. Judge, what's your response to her statement?
Well, my response is that I would hope that she would reconsider that position while there is still time to do so. Her decision is respectfully rooted in the same kinds of baseless lies and smears that the religious claims against Mr. Manji were based. Associating him with terrorists and anti-Semites and so forth, none of which is true, and the record clearly demonstrates that. The same is true here. The organization that we are talking about is a group that reached out to Mr. Manji to ask for pro bono services on behalf of an inmate who had been murdered in the New York prison system. And this was not even a criminal case. It was a civil lawsuit that he brought. He achieved a landmark settlement on behalf of the family that not only helped the prisoner's family, but also helped the prison. And in doing so, helped prison guards because the cameras were installed throughout the prison. This is honorable work. This is the kind of work that we value, we encourage in our profession.
And we should note that Senator Cortez Masto has voted for at least one judicial nominee in the past who represented a man charged with murdering a police officer that was under the Trump administration. And so has Senator Ted Cruz, as well as a number of other Republicans, voted for judicial nominees who were either represented people who were charged or convicted of murdering police officers. But, Judge, I do want to ask you, it isn't new for judicial nominees to face partisan attacks. And so is this just the price of politics now for judicial nominees?
When I see this sort of thing happen, it is beyond politics. Obviously, politics plays a role in judicial nominations and in just about everything else that happens in the Senate and in the House and in Washington. But this is way beyond that. You know, it's interesting that you just noted those other votes that were taken in connection with people who had committed heinous crimes against police officers, and they were voted affirmatively by Senator Cruz and by others. They were not Muslims. I mean, we cannot allow ourselves to really debase ourselves by sinking to such a level. This is the first Muslim nominee for an appeals court in the history of the United States. And under the thin pretext of these issues that have been thoroughly debunked, we are seeing people change their votes or decide not to vote in favor. And it's just a very sad moment.
Judge, in your letter to Senators Schumer and Senators McConnell, you said that rejecting Mr. Manji's nomination would have a toxic long-term impact on the entire federal judiciary. We need more diversity on the bench. What long-term impact are you talking about there?
I know, because I've been told by other members of the Muslim faith in the wake of what has happened to Mr. Manji, and these are very prominent Muslim lawyers, that they do not feel that it would be worth pursuing a federal judgeship in this climate and in this atmosphere. That is awful. That is terrible, and that should not be condoned. We need diversity on the federal bench and on appellate courts and courts throughout the country because of the lived experience that each judge, each person who serves brings. And how we see how that manifests at the United States Supreme Court level and below. And it's very important that we have that.
That's former federal judge Timothy K. Lewis. Thank you for your time.
It's my pleasure and my honor. Thank you for having me.
In an historic first, a kidney from a genetically modified pig has been successfully transplanted into a human. As William Brangham reports, the technique used in the surgery last weekend is a big step forward and could have wide implications.
The patient here is a 62-year-old black man whose kidneys were failing and he was on dialysis for years. This kind of human-to-animal transplant, known as xenotransplantation, is one that researchers hope to do more of because there aren't nearly enough human organs for the thousands of people in need. But putting animal tissue into a human body is complicated. The body often rejects foreign tissue. So in this case, scientists removed several genes from the pig that can trigger that rejection. To help us understand this brave new world, we are joined by Dr. Leonardo Riella. He's the medical director for kidney transplantation at Massachusetts General Hospital, where this historic event took place. Dr. Riella, so good to have you on the program. Congratulations on this historic, successful first. I take it is still successful, right? The patient is doing well?
The patient is doing extremely well. Thank you for asking.
And what is his, his prognosis? Normally, if you had a kidney transplant, how soon would he be getting out of the hospital? And do you know when he will be getting out?
Yeah, so most patients remain in the hospital after a kidney transplant for about 5 to 6 days. On his case, we're probably going to keep about a week or 9 days just to make sure everything is okay. But all the signs that we had so far, in particular the blood tests and things that we follow, are extremely positive. So, and he has been off dialysis since he got his transplant last Saturday.
It's amazing. Before we get into some of the complexities here, we were all very struck by seeing how moved you were at the press conference when you announced this breakthrough. And I just wonder, if I had talked to you back when you were a younger man in medical school and I had told you that you could have cured someone's end-stage renal disease with a pig kidney, what would younger you have thought about that?
That was just a dream, a big dream, and maybe it would never happen.
And what is it, again, for people who might have thought, well, I've heard that we can put parts of pig hearts into people or other animal transplantations. What is it that has been the challenge thus far that you were able to surmount here?
So, you know, if we go back 20, 30 years when xenotransplant started, there had been so many challenges, in particular what was mentioned before about these incompatibilities. And changing the DNA to make animals more compatible was extremely difficult. I think what really changed was a game changer was the development of the CRISPR-Cas technology. And so the discovery and then the application of that in xenotransplantation, because then scientists were able to modify multiple genes at the same time in a short period of time, which, you know, before was impossible. And that permitted us to overcome all these barriers and make organs that were really more compatible with humans.
And is that why you think that this case was successful when other previous attempts have not been?
Well, that's one point that is very important, is the type of donor organ that we're going to get. What type of gene-modified pigs are donating these kidneys so that we can do a successful transplant? I think the second aspect is, what are the medications that we're going to be giving this patient in order to prevent it from rejecting? What we've learned from all preclinical models, so animal studies, is that the usual immune suppressive drugs, anti-rejection medications that we use in the clinic, do not seem to be effective in the case of xenotransplantation. And what we had to do is then adapt some of the new drugs that were being developed. And for the first time, we used one of these medications on the current patient. And I think that was so far a success. Of course, rejection takes time, so we have to follow this patient carefully. But the initial impression is only positive from our team.
Can you help me understand a little bit the potential that you and your colleagues see for this type of thing, given the enormous need, tens of thousands of people, and we know the big disparities in racial minorities in the country?
Yeah, those are huge. The disparity in kidney transplantation keeps increasing, and as well as the organ shortage. So patients don't get referred for transplant, and when they do get referred, they have to wait on a waiting list years before getting a transplant. And unfortunately, while they stay on dialysis, their health deteriorate. So while they were initial candidates for a kidney transplant when they first entered the list, if they wait 4 or 5 years, many of them will not be candidates anymore. So I think what we hope to be able to do is that one first step in getting more organs for these patients so they can be transplanted in a timely manner.
There have been a series of concerns that have been raised about using gene-edited organs in humans, about the potential for spreading animal viruses from animals to humans. How do you weigh those risks versus the potential that you're talking about here?
That's always a major debate in the entire field of xenotransplantation. So how high are the risks? And what we have learned over the past 20 years with many animal studies is that if these pigs are grown in a very isolated manner with frequent testing, you're able to actually, you know, have a very low risk of infections. And I think what was unique about the pig that donated the kidney for our patient was that in addition to the improvements in compatibility that we just mentioned, they also did 59 modifications in the gene, in particular in some retroviruses that are present endogenously on the pig. And so that creates an extra level of safety in terms of minimizing infections coming from the pig. And then we tested for all the other pathogens, bacteria and viruses that could be present on the pig to make sure that they were negative prior to transplantation, and that reassures. So the risk overall we consider very low, but of course, this is the first time we're doing this in humans, so we're going to be monitoring this very carefully.
All right, Dr. Leonardo Riella of Massachusetts General Hospital, thank you so much, and again, congratulations on this historic breakthrough.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
With House Republicans facing yet another fight over who will lead their conference and a host of other political stories driving this week's news, we turn to the analysis of Brooks and Capehart. That's New York Times columnist David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart, associate editor for The Washington Post. Great to see you all, as always. So House Speaker Mike Johnson is facing the first direct threat to his speakership after Republican Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene filed what's known as a motion to vacate against him today for working with Democrats to fund the government. Jonathan, this resolution is not privileged, which in plain English means the House doesn't have to vote on it until Marjorie Taylor Greene says so, which effectively means that Speaker Johnson has this axe hanging over his head. How do you see this playing out?
Well, the Speaker has had this axe hanging over his head since the moment he got the job. And when he got the job, the conventional wisdom was, because he's from that faction of the far right of the House, he will have a honeymoon period, that he will be able to do things that then Speaker McCarthy wasn't able to do, or the things that made him lose his job. And what we're seeing now is, and I think one of the last few weekends, few Fridays I was here where I was asked this question, and I said, he's living in fear of this motion to vacate. And well, Marjorie Taylor Greene today decided, well, today's the day that I'm going to file this motion. But you raise a key point. She didn't file it as a privileged motion. If she really wanted him out, she would have done that, and that would have forced them to get to vote on it in two legislative days. The way she's done it, they could punt it to a committee, and you know that's where it would go to die. But he has always been facing this threat, and now that it's out there, the key question for me is, what do Democrats do?
Well, on that point, Congressman Tim Burchett said that if the House had voted today on this motion to vacate, it's entirely possible that Hakeem Jeffries could have ended up as Speaker, given the way the votes might have fallen and how narrow that majority is.
Yeah, I mean the first thing, the antics that she's doing are driving good people out of the House. Mm-hmm. And so Mike Gallagher announced he's going to leave next month. And Mike Gallagher, I've seen him present on China and things like that. It's like watching a scholar present. One of the finest minds in the House. Damning with faint praise, I get you. But so he's leaving. So if you're like Ben Sass left the Senate, if it's just going to be craziness, why stick around? And so that has just a long-term effect on the country. I think I look at the upside, as always. And I think if Johnson gets in trouble, Democrats are always saying, we'll vote for Johnson if he brings the Senate's Ukraine aid bill up. And so if it could force the House to vote on that bill and to pass the Ukraine aid bill, he could do that with Democratic votes, he would keep his job, and the country would be a winner.
What are the incentives for Democrats to help Johnson out if that's what is needed?
Well, it depends on who you ask. I did a reach out to some members. And what's interesting is the common refrain has been, or the, I should say the thing that I've gotten back mostly, is a standalone Ukraine bill. Mm-hmm. A few others said not a damn thing. I was wondering whether I could say the word damn on PBS, but there are Democrats who don't, no, we're not going to do anything to help Speaker Johnson. But the key thing is, it doesn't matter what those individual members say to me. What really matters is what Leader Jeffries says, because I think that's where the majority of the conference is going to take its lead.
Meantime, Donald Trump needs to find $500 million, and he has to find it fairly quickly. He has until Monday to post a bond covering the full amount of the $454 million civil fraud judgment against him as he appeals this ruling. And if he can't somehow find the money, the New York AG, Letitia James, she might start seizing some of his assets to help cover that obligation. David, for any candidate running for public office, especially the presidency, who is short on cash and who has to find $454 million. That is a serious liability, and it also raises, in this case, some national security questions.
Yeah, I mean, I have a few problems with the seizure. The Associated Press did a good survey. They looked back at 70 years of cases like this, and in cases where there was no clear victim, they've never seized assets before. And so if the people who claim a lot of this is a political witch hunt, I think that Associated Press, I found it kind of alarming that the Trump case is not being treated like the other cases. Nonetheless, it is what it is. And so he's got to raise a lot of money really fast. And can he do it through Truth Social? His very weird online social media outlet is on the market. Suddenly it would boost his net worth $3 billion, which is also troubling because it made, in the first 9 months of last year, it made $3.3 million and is valued at $3 billion. Mm. So it looks to me like another form of fundraising. Disguised as investment. And that is already crooked. And then you take what a desperate Donald Trump was likely to do, do what his son-in-law did, go to the Saudis and get some money. It just opens up for a desperate Donald Trump all sorts of corrupt possibilities.
One of Donald Trump's attorneys was on Fox recently, and the anchor in this instance asked if he would accept money from Saudi Arabia or Russia to help cover this bond. Here's how that played out.
Is there any effort on the part of your team to secure this money through another country, Saudi Arabia or Russia, as Joy Behar seems to think?
Well, there's rules and regulations that are public. I can't speak about strategy that require certain things, and we have to follow those rules.
I'm curious by the use of the word strategy. I don't know. I think someone who's running for president of the United States should automatically say, yeah, I owe $500 million. I'm not going to go to foreign governments because that would open me up as president of the United States to foreign interference and foreign influence. But we're not talking about any old regular person. And of course, he's going to take the money from wherever he can get it. I mean, that's been his entire career. And I have to disagree. I have to disagree with David. No. Take the properties. If any of us at the table were in that situation, we would be in serious trouble. And, you know, it would be within the right of the Attorney General to say, you know what, we're going to take your golf club, or we're going to take your tower. And, you know, quite honestly, I would love to see the AG, the New York Attorney General, do that, because then it would be like the most tangible sign for the nation, the world, and for Donald Trump that you have been held accountable.
Well, as we reported earlier, there was this U.S.-sponsored resolution calling for an immediate ceasefire between Israel and Hamas in Gaza. It failed to pass the U.N. Security Council today. But it still marks, David, a toughening of the U.S. stance toward Israel by the Biden administration, which had vetoed two previous resolutions. How do you see this relationship, and how do you see this playing out?
It's unprecedented that there is this much tension between Israel and the United States. And I think the Biden administration is right on a couple things and wrong on one big thing. They're right to demand a ceasefire, or to try to get a ceasefire so there can be humanitarian aid to go in. They're right to pressure Israel to take moral responsibility and strategic responsibility for the Gazans, for the people who are there. They're also right that Israel has to have a day-after plan. And so all that thing, I think the administration is absolutely correct to be pressuring Israel on. Where I differ is on their new policy this week that Israel should not go into Gaza in the way they think they have to. Now, according to the IDF, the Israeli Defense Forces, there are 6,000 to 8,000 Hamas fighters in there. You can't leave Hamas in power after this. There's no possibility for a two-state solution. There's no possibility for economic reconstruction. There's no possibility that foreign NGOs, if Hamas emerges from this surviving, competent, and frankly victorious. So Israel can't go into Rafah the way they went into Gaza City with that massive destruction and doing insufficient to get the civilians out of there. But in my view, it's terrible, but they have to go into Rafah because they have to eliminate Hamas to have a decent future.
And Jonathan, what about this relationship between Netanyahu and President Biden? President Biden, he's an old school politician. He believes that personal relationships are how you get stuff done. As it was described to me, the two of them met each other 40 years ago when Joe Biden was the junior senator from Delaware and Netanyahu was the deputy chief of mission here in Washington. Did President Biden put too much stock in their personal relationship early on?
Perhaps he did, just leader to leader. Hey, we've known each other a long time. We're the United States. We're allies. Please listen to me. Listen to us. And what the prime minister has done time and time again in private, but also increasingly in public, is defy the president, defy Biden, defy the United States, which I think explains why we have seen a ratcheting up of this pressure that you're talking about on the part of the United States towards Israel. But I try to make a distinction here when talking about this. There is, I don't think, much daylight between the United States' support for the nation of Israel. What we are seeing, however, is a lot of daylight, yawning daylight, between Joe Biden and Benjamin Netanyahu. And this is where those personal relationships come into play.
Jonathan Capehart and David Brooks, great conversation. Thank you both.
Thanks, Jeff.
Lenny Kravitz has been busy. A new single out today from his album set for release in May, and an international tour this summer. And earlier this month, he earned a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. I spoke with Kravitz in Los Angeles, and we visited some of his old haunts for our arts and culture series, Canvas. I wish that I could fly into the sky. Lenny Kravitz seamlessly blends rock, funk, soul, and R&B. Resulting in a sound uniquely his own. With a career spanning nearly four decades, he has not only captivated audiences worldwide with chart-topping hits, but has also become a symbol of artistic authenticity and individualism. Always effortlessly cool. We spoke with Lenny Kravitz about his life, career, and new album at the El Rey Theater in Los Angeles.
Your music defies categorization. How are you able to resist the commercial demands, especially earlier in your career, to fit a specific genre or appeal to a specific audience?
I never had the desire to do that, thus me turning down those record deals when I was a teenager.
It would have been easy to accept one of them. How did you know?
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely, yeah. And not only that, I needed it, and I wanted it so badly. I wanted to be making music. And so when you have people offering you, you know, at a young age, we're gonna give you money, we're gonna give you the opportunity, you're gonna go to Europe, and we're gonna, you know, put you in the studio with big producers, and then you're going to go on tour, and you know, these are the things you've been dreaming of as a child. But every time they offered me that situation, it came with, you know, you can't make that music that we just listened to you making. You have to do this, because this is what works. This is the formula. This is what a black artist should be doing. This is what making hit records is. But there was always this feeling inside of me that when I was about to say yes, felt very uncomfortable. And I shut down. My body would not let me do it. And I said no each time. And I'd walk off the lot of the record label and get back on that 212 bus going down La Brea to wherever the hell I was going at the time. Yeah.
We spent the day with Lenny Kravitz, and he took us to that bus stop, the symbolic starting point for a transformative career that would solidify his status as one of the preeminent musicians of our time, starting with his debut 1989 album, Let Love Rule.
Every time I pass this place, I always think about those days.
Yeah, your face lights up when you talk about it. It's really incredible that you've never lost sight of this.
No, I never will. You know, it's all part of the adventure, and I spent a lot of time sitting here and thinking about life and making music, and so it's very close to my heart.
Performance is ingrained in his DNA. His father, Cy Kravitz, was a TV news producer. His mother, Roxy Roker, was an actress who found TV fame on Norman Lear's classic sitcom, The Jeffersons.
Are the Howards by any chance an interracial couple?
His was a multiracial, multi-ethnic household, Ukrainian Jewish and Afro-Caribbean. His family moved to the historic Baldwin Hills neighborhood of Los Angeles when he was in high school.
So what memories does this house hold for you?
This is everything. This was the first house my family owned, my mom and my dad. We moved out here in 75 when the Jeffersons started, but this became the center of our family functions and all the parties that my mom had, you know, with all of these black pioneers that were doing everything at the time in every field, you know. Everybody stuck together. Everybody was extended family. And so everything happened in this house, man.
Yeah.
As we were talking, neighbors and old family friends came out to say hello and catch up.
Oh my God.
Lenny says he finds a comfort and a steadiness in these relationships and values that shaped him from the start.
Good to see you.
In your book, you wrote that your life is one of opposites, black and white, Jewish and Christian, Jackson 5 and Led Zeppelin. How has that manifested in your work?
More contrast than opposites. Beautiful contrast. Having this wide range and not paying attention to so-called boundaries just gave me more colors to play with, more depth. So I'd make my stew and use all of these things that people maybe thought shouldn't be all put together, but that's what I was making.
Beyond his musical success, Lenny Kravitz has made an imprint in the realms of fashion, design, and acting, appearing as Cinna in the Hunger Games franchise.
Will I be twirling tonight?
Save it for the end.
He also had roles in the critically acclaimed Lee Daniels films Precious and The Butler. But even with four consecutive Grammy Awards, 11 studio albums which have sold 40 million copies worldwide, it hasn't been easy making a way in an industry that doesn't always value individuality.
Do you feel like the cultural gatekeepers, the music gatekeepers, had to catch up to you and had to catch up to what you're doing?
I don't really pay much attention to that, but like the people that influenced me, sometimes you just gotta be ahead of the game. Mm-hmm. And you may not get whatever, attention or accolades or what, you know, whatever it might be, but that doesn't matter. It's about the journey, you know?
Do you ever feel underappreciated for your barrier breaking and all of your contributions to music and the culture?
No, because I appreciate it. I appreciate the life that God's given me and what I'm doing. And not that I need validation, but when you have people that did give you that, whether it was Miles Davis after he heard my first album, or it was Mick Jagger, or it was Robert Plant, or it was Prince, or it was Curtis Mayfield, the people that taught you, the people that you look up to, they were befriending me. They were supporting me. They understood what I was doing. That gave me a lot of fuel.
And the whole reason I create and perform music is to amplify love.
And he says his love affair with music still hasn't lost its spark.
How do you maintain that? 40 million plus records sold. You've been in this business for 35 years. Rock and Roll Hall of Fame nominee this year. I mean, how does all of that strike you? And how do you then also maintain that same creative spark?
I think it's my love for music, period. I love music. I always have loved music. I was born to make music. Music has created my life. It has saved my life. It has brought me meaning and joy and purpose. And I think by nature, I'm an extremely grateful person. I wake up every day grateful for life, every day.
Lenny Kravitz's 12th studio album, Blue Electric Light, his first in 6 years, is scheduled for release in May, ahead of a world tour kicking off this summer.
And online, you can hear more from Lenny Kravitz on the inspiration behind one of my favorite songs, that's I Belong to You, and that's on our YouTube channel.
And finally tonight, Charles Duhigg is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist and best-selling author whose latest book seeks to unlock the secret language of communication. Here he shares his brief but spectacular take on connecting with others.
The goal of a conversation is not to convince someone else that you're right. It's not even to come to agreement or find a common ground. The only goal of a conversation is to understand each other. So my relationship with small talk is that I used to be terrified of it until I started doing this research about how to have conversations, in which I learned the key for small talk is to get deep as fast as possible. The best way to get deep with someone is to ask a deep question. And a deep question asks someone about their values or their beliefs or their experiences. And this can seem intimidating, but it's as easy as meeting someone who says they're a lawyer and saying, oh, what made you decide to go to law school? Or do you love practicing the law? Those are easy questions to ask, but they invite the other person to really tell you who they are in a meaningful way. My favorite question is when someone tells me something, say, oh, that's really interesting. What does that mean to you? And the other person feels like I'm so curious about their life, which I actually am. I have 9 siblings, and as you might imagine, dinnertime conversation was challenging. What I discovered is if I could make everyone laugh, it was like magic. And that's kind of one of the things that got me so interested in understanding communication. Why sometimes am I able to do that? And at other times, I want to connect with someone and I just can't. My book is called Super Communicators: Unlocking the Secret Language of Connection. This is a book about why some people manage to connect with others so much more, what we know about the science behind conversation, and how we can learn the skills that help us connect and have real meaningful conversations with almost anyone. The biggest roadblocks to having a real conversation with someone is twofold. First of all, oftentimes we're anxious. And so one thing that you can do is just write down a couple of topics that you want to discuss before you start the conversation. And then the second thing that we can do is prove that we're listening. Show the other person by repeating back what they say, by asking questions, that we're listening closely and we want to understand them. Laughter is a great example. 80% of the time when we laugh, it's not in response to something funny. It's to show someone that we want to connect with them. And then when they laugh back, they're showing they want to connect with us. Almost all discussions fall into one of 3 kinds of conversation. There's practical conversations, which is about decision-making and solving problems and making plans. And then there's emotional conversations, where I might tell you how I feel, and I don't want you to solve this for me. I want you to empathize and listen. And then there's social conversations, which is about how we relate to each other and how we relate to society. And the key is what's known as the matching principle, which says that in order to communicate with each other, we need to be having the same kind of conversation at the same moment. Communication is humans' superpower. It's what has allowed the Homo sapiens to be so successful. The more we learn how communication works, the more we understand how to take a conversation apart and fiddle with its gears, the more we allow our own instincts to come out. And the truth is, we were born to connect with each other. We just have to learn how to listen to that. My name is Charles Duhigg, and this is my brief but spectacular take on super communication.
And as always, you can watch more brief but spectacular videos online at pbs.org/newshour/brief.
A late news update now to the shooting at a rock concert in Moscow that killed 40 people, according to Russia's security service. U.S. officials tell the NewsHour that the U.S. warned Russian authorities earlier this month that a terror attack was imminent in Russia. On Tuesday, Russian President Vladimir Putin labeled that American caution a, quote, blatant attempt to destabilize Russian society. And we invite you to tune into Washington Week with The Atlantic tonight for a look at the growing tensions between the U.S. and Israel over the war in Gaza.
And on PBS News Weekend tomorrow, we take a closer look at the working conditions of migrant farm laborers and their role in the U.S. economy. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz.
And I'm Jeff Bennett. Thanks for spending part of your evening with us, and have a great weekend.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
It was like an aha moment. This is what I love doing. Early stage companies have this energy that energizes me. These are people who are trying to change the world. When I volunteer with women entrepreneurs, it's the same thing. I'm helping people reach their dreams. I'm thriving by helping others every day. People who know BDO.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Kathy and Paul Anderson, and Camilla and George Smith. The Walton Family Foundation, working for solutions to protect water during climate change so people and nature can thrive together. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, for more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.